I have to show you like where I am because
I would love to see.
It's like this really like weird street corner, and I found this green wall.
You have a great background.
And like I think you can only do this in New York because there's all these weird things going on in New York anyway. Everyone though is like walking past this corner and they're like, "What is she doing? It's so
they're
weird."
Like, hey,
so,
are you on the phone? Who are you talking to?
Yeah, what is she doing?
Amanda Smith here with ESPN's Colorado College. Thank you for taking time out of your busy, busy life to chat with me. You're literally on the street right now.
I am. I'm on the streets of New York City, but that is what we do in this world. We find time no matter where we are, and it's probably a good commentary on what my life is at this point. But anyway, it's so good to see you.
So you've been at the network now since 2014. How would you describe the way that you've grown since that first time you picked up an ESPN mic?
It's a great question because in 2014, I think when I look back on what I was at that point and the growth that was needed to be fully comfortable in my own skin, I really realized that a lot has changed just over a relatively short period of time. And I think one of the big reasons why is I finally simply decided to trust myself and say, okay, you are enough, you know enough. And it's just, that's so difficult to do. And I still struggle with it on a daily basis, but I really think that's one of the biggest pieces of advice that I can give to anybody who wants to do this is just know that you are enough and that you are beyond good enough and beyond prepared enough, but just as a person and who you are to your core, that's enough. So finally understanding that, and then also just getting some great opportunities and finding a way to, you know, rise to the challenge, I think did sort of allow for my growth at ESPN. And I'm just really thankful for it. It's been a lot of fun, a lot of hard work, not a lot of sleep, but just really, really grateful that it's gone this way.
What is sleep? Who knows? Some of those opportunities this year, we've seen you on shows like Get Up, SportsCenter. Why do you think it's so important to step into those new roles, even if it's something you never thought initially, like, this is what I'm going to be a part of?
Right. So I had always watched SportsCenter and just thought I could never do that. I mean, I really thought, like, there is no way I could ever do that. The studio looks so intimidating, and just the whole thing just seems scary to me. And so when they asked me if I'd be interested in doing some SportsCenter, I was kind of like looking over my shoulder like, me? Are you kidding me? I mean, you know, there's got to be somebody better. But, you know, stepping outside your comfort zone and saying, hey, whatever comes my way is going to be okay, and trusting in your preparation and really trusting in the fact that everything that you have done up until this point, everything that's been put into your life and put into your career is there to prepare you for those moments. And doors that wouldn't open sooner for me that I thought maybe should have, I look back and say, okay, I wasn't ready yet for it then. But whenever I was put in a situation to do it, I mean, I still made a million mistakes on my very first SportsCenter, but I was ready. I could handle it. And then the Get Up thing was pretty interesting because that just really came out of left field. And I thought I was just filling in. I did not think that, you know, it would become a more regular thing. I really thought it was just a kind of a one-off, you know, they need somebody because people are on vacation. And it's been really neat because I really do think that in this day and age in media, whether it's sports or not, but specifically to sports, you have to be so versatile and you have to be able to do so many types of shows. So SportsCenter is a lot different from Get Up and from Sideline. And I think as you find ways to, you know, develop your credit to be as versatile as possible.
So for today's segment of Get to Know Laura a Little Better, I thought it would be fun to give people an idea of the work that goes into the job that you do. So what is the next game that you'll be covering?
Oh, I'm doing the Temple UCF game on Thursday night, ESPN College Football. So basically that prep starts on Sunday. And then it goes all the way through up until the game. But like today, for instance, I started the day at 5 a.m., did Get Up. And then as soon as I was done with that, did some production meetings for that Thursday game. And then I've been doing player interviews throughout the day. So I've had a couple of Temple players. I'll do that. We'll have some coaches called. And then when I actually get to Orlando tomorrow, it's really more on Wednesday, I'll do the UCF player interviews and do a bunch of stuff in preparation for that game. So it's kind of funny because during the week, as I'm preparing for all this stuff, it's almost like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday is a conglomeration of prep for either the Thursday game or SEC Nation
or Get Up or College Football Live, like all at once.
So that's like, why we find ourselves checked as you're walking down the street.
Exactly.
I want to get to some of the fan questions that we had for you before we're out of time. So Solly Lowe would like to know, does Ohio State have any chance of getting into the playoffs?
Yeah, Ohio State does. I mean, obviously they would need some help, but we've seen crazy things happen. And I think if they could win the Big Ten, which would mean, well, first of all, they'd have to beat Michigan, and then they would have to have another big win. They would be in a scenario where their strength of schedule would be good enough that the committee might have to look at it if some other teams lose. Like, let's say, for instance, LSU beats Alabama this week, okay? So then Alabama may be out of contention at that point. They might still get in, depending on other things, but let's say they're out. Then you've got a team like Oklahoma. Let's say Oklahoma suffers another loss. Let's say Notre Dame gets beat. There are so many things that could happen in this crazy month of November that could end up affecting it. So Ohio State needs some help, but they're still a very good team. And I think they could get in. And I think if they did get in, they would be a competitive playoff team.
Solly, super happy for him. He's going to be excited about that. All right. Jason Ross Jr. 1 says, you are one of his favorite broadcasters to watch. How does someone become so conversational and relaxed on camera?
So that's a great question, because I think the main thing with that is that it just takes time. And I look back and I'll look back at video of myself and be like, oh my goodness, I was so stiff. And I used to do this thing where I would be holding the microphone and my other arm would be like doing a chicken jig or something. I don't even know what it was. And I wasn't even aware that I was doing it. And I didn't notice it until I would start to look back at footage and say, oh man, what is that weird thing I'm doing? And you know, it just took me years to feel comfortable. And there's still times where I'll get nervous, but I think the main thing is before anything that I do, if I'm feeling nerves creep in, or if I'm feeling just, you know, not myself, just taking a really deep breath. It sounds simple, but it calms you down. And remembering that at the end of the day, people don't want you to be perfect. No one likes that, okay? Like, they want you to be factually correct. They want you to have done your research. They want you to have done your homework. They don't care if you have a word wrong or you accidentally make a mistake and then you have to correct yourself. That's okay. And to me, I think just being real, it's harder than you would think, but it's a huge benefit. Another thing that helped me being conversational is doing a lot of radio. So if you're looking into, you know, being on TV, I would recommend radio as a great vehicle to just figure out what your style is going to be, figure out how you're going to be conversational on air, and how you're going to be comfortable.
Why do you think that the radio aspect helped you so much moving into television?
Yeah, so I think the biggest thing was by the time I got on TV, I was already really comfortable broadcasting, and I didn't even mean to be. Like, I didn't really want to do TV. I kind of just only wanted to do radio, but being on radio and being on there for so long, because a lot of times it's like a 2-hour show, in a 2-hour time span, you have a lot of time to make some mistakes or do some things wrong, do some things right, and really experiment with yourself and say, okay, that wasn't very good. That didn't sound great. Let me try to say it this way the next time around. Just putting myself out of my comfort zone a little bit too on radio. I would even do like lacrosse radio shows in college. I don't know that much about lacrosse. It didn't matter, because when you put yourself in a scenario where you're not totally comfortable, you learn a lot more about yourself. And the next time you go back to what you're really comfortable in, you're way better. So I think it's twofold. A lot of it's based on feeling really confident in your knowledge on radio, because it's more about that than anything else. And then also just getting to that place where you just try a few things. This business is so trial and error. It's so preference-based. You know, that you need to have that time to figure that out. And sometimes you don't have enough time on TV to get to that point.
Taylor_Lehman6, who has made the biggest impact on you while working in this industry?
So many people that I've been so thankful to have as advisors and just have as encouragers. I would say that for me, you know, kind of my idol has always been Doris Burke, and just the way that she broadcasts and the way that she comes at it. You know, obviously she's a woman, but no one sits there and talks about that. They're talking about her knowledge and her experience in basketball. And I truly think that she's one of the best analysts that we have in any sport, whether it's basketball or anything else. So she's been wonderful, and she's somebody that I will just always sit down and watch her because I think she's fantastic.
I recently met Doris Burke, and the whole thing is such a blur to me. She was so kind and so nice, but I'm like, I don't remember one word I said to you.
That's usually how it goes, right? Another person that I'm very thankful for and just kind of trying to model what I do after is Scott Van Pelt. I think his unique style on TV, his just ability to be so comfortable at any time, you know, he's going to make you laugh. He's going to make you cry. He's very emotional without being over the top. It's authentic, you know. So I think that's one of my favorite things about him and something that I tried my best to emulate, getting nowhere close to what he does, but just think he's absolutely wonderful.
Okay, final question. Swashbucklers would like to know, what is the most challenging part of your job?
I think the most challenging part is the schedule and the travel. And Marty Smith actually said this to me recently. He said that he always tells people that he gets paid to travel. But what we actually do as our jobs is so much fun, and it's just, we're so thankful for it. It's just wonderful. But I do think that the travel and sometimes the schedule and, like I said, the lack of sleep and everything, it can be challenging. But my biggest problem is that I just want to do everything. So I don't ever want to say, you know what, I probably need some rest time for my body to, like, recover. Recently, I got really sick because I just wouldn't slow down. And it was a good sign of, or a good reminder of, hey, you know what, sometimes it's okay to slow down. And I think, like, as you, as anybody watching this gets into their career and just wants to, you know, go, go, go all the time, remember to take care of you too in all of this, because no one else is really going to take care of you. I mean, when you're working in local TV or even regional or national TV, they're going to use you. Like, if you say that you're ready to go, they're going to say, all right, get there. And I always have taken this approach of, I just feel so thankful that I have this job that I don't want to say no to anything. And I always feel like it could be taken away at any point in time. And, you know, it's not even like a competitive thing. Like, someone, I'm looking over my shoulder because I hope whoever comes next is awesome. And I hope they take my job. I hope all of you take my job. It's more just like, I want to soak it all up, you know, while I have it. But I do think that it's important to take care of yourself and important to take a step back every once in a while and, you know, be present with your family, be present with your friends, and make sure that you're filling yourself up with some good vibes and not just, you know, emptying your tank on work all the time.
On the contrary, what do you think is the most rewarding?
Oh, the best thing is telling people's stories. I think just naturally I'm a curious person. Some people might call it nosy, but I've always loved people and their personalities and just finding out what makes people click. I mean, I love hearing somebody's background and why they are where they are and what happened to them to make them a certain way, and just like lending that ear and hearing from them and having people trust us or me to tell their story and to represent them fairly and to represent them in the right way is just something that I take so much joy in. And I'm always pinching myself when someone tells me something. It's like, it's so fun when you hear something and you're like, wow, that's so cool. And the person's like, is it really? And I'm like, yeah, no, I love it. You know, it's amazing. I think naturally, like, one of my favorite things to do is encourage people and just love on people. So to be able to hear their stories and then tell them and have an opportunity to just tell them how much I appreciate that in the process is the most rewarding part of my job.
This has been such a treat for me. I've been such a huge fan of yours for so long. So I can't thank you enough for making the time to.
Oh my goodness. Thank you. Thank you for bearing with me in this crazy sound. And if anybody like couldn't hear something or wants to reach out to me, you can always send me a tweet or an Instagram message or anything like that, because I would love to keep in touch with everybody, and especially you, Amanda. I appreciate you reaching out to me.
Sorry. Well, I just had one of those moments again where I don't remember anything that happened. All right, guys. Well, thank you for hanging out with us today. For Laura Rutledge, I'm Amanda Smith. We'll see you next time.